schools, elementary and middle school. Good evening. Welcome to New Albany Floyd County Schools Elementary and Middle School Digital Synchronous Virtual Learning Orientation. My name is Steve Griffin. I'm Assistant Superintendent here. I have the privilege of working with our middle schools. To my right is Mr. Tony Duffy. He's Assistant Superintendent of Elementary Education and Title I Services. To my left, we have Mr. Kyle Wonke. He's a district e-learning coach with us. And we also have Michelle Faree, who is our Student Services Director. We have Dr. Louis Jensen, who's with us, and he will be taking your questions out there as you send them to us via email. So the email address is dsl@nafcs.org. One of the main reasons that we wanted to go live tonight was to be able to interact with you live, essentially, so that we can answer questions that you may have, and we'll be doing that throughout the course of the presentation tonight. So feel free to send us those emails, and we're going to do our very best to answer as many as we possibly can tonight. Taking a look at our agenda, what we're going to try to get covered tonight is taking a look at what digital synchronous virtual learning is. What will that experience be for your student and you? What will you see and learn from that? We'll be taking a look at a couple of elementary and middle school schedules. Model schedules that will be shared with you tonight so you can get a feel for what your child will experience virtually. We'll also take a look at student devices and responsibilities. We want to make sure that our students are comfortable and responsible with those devices. We'll be navigating through Google Classroom and Google Meet. These are going to be two very important tools that we're going to be using this school year to communicate and effectively interact with our virtual students. We'll talk a little bit about student expectations regarding the virtual environment, and then we'll talk also a little bit about parent-teacher communications and parent-student resources, and as I mentioned earlier, we'll follow it up with any questions that you may have. So as we're going through this presentation, feel free to send those emails to us. So what is DSL? It's a digital synchronous learning, the virtual student ride. A student that's going to be enrolled and the digital synchronous learning has the same rights and responsibilities as any student that's going to be with us face-to-face. We will be honest with you, we think face-to-face instruction is the most effective mode of instruction, but we also know we are in unprecedented times, and we want to make sure that families that do not feel ready to come back, when we're ready to come back, will have this virtual option. So we want to talk through what that is. Now, DSL virtual students, they may still participate in clubs, sports. So students in grades 5 through 12, if they're enrolled in at least 5 classes, they're going to be eligible to participate in sports in New Albany Floyd County Schools, performing arts. We want to treat our virtual DSL students just like we would if they are coming to us traditionally. And we do want to emphasize that a student may return to the traditional schedule anytime during the school year. So we want to work with parents. We want to try to make sure students aren't hopping in and out of traditional and virtual options, but we do know that things happen, and we want to work with you as New Albany Floyd County families to accommodate your needs. We do want to mention real quick, we've had just our teachers, our administrators, our support staff, we've been working extremely hard this summer to prepare for this upcoming school year. Our teachers have volunteered a lot of summer training time, spring and summer, to be honest with you. And the options that we're going to talk about, we want to reemphasize that it's not going to really look like spring at all. Okay? We were thrust into that model in March, and we feel like that we've created a much more robust, much more enriching model for our students moving forward. So we just want to make sure we reiterate that for you. We want to kind of shift and talk a little bit about students with individual education plans, IEPs, and so what I'd like to do is turn it over to Ms. Faree to talk a little bit about how we will best accommodate our students with IEPs.
Thank you, Dr. Griffin. This is unknown territory for us, so we certainly understand our obligations to develop quality individualized education plans that are well calculated, reasonable, and appropriate for students. So we will be reaching out to the parents who've chosen virtual and asking to meet with you, to talk with you about what services will be provided, what you might expect during a virtual learning experience, and to hear from you and allow you to give us input on the development of the educational program. But understanding that we have no prior experience in providing virtual services, so we're going to ask that you be patient with us, that we communicate with one another, and that we certainly work together to develop the best plan for your student during the virtual learning time.
Yes, Ms. Faria, I got a question for you. Just came in. Before school was shut down in March, I had signed documents at my son's middle school to begin having him tested. This has not been done yet.
That is correct. We were unable to provide any type of educational evaluations in the spring because the governor gave an executive order to close schools, which meant that we could not bring students in for individualized evaluations. That process has been restarted. School psychologists are reaching out to those families. We have been evaluating students in the past week to 2 weeks. And if you have not heard from a school psychologist and you have signed that paperwork and you believe the evaluation is coming due, please reach out to me, and you can find my information on the New Albany Floyd County website under the Student Support Services information.
Okay, Dr. Griffin, a couple of general questions to begin with. Can twins be in the same class?
Yeah, I think we've made that accommodation in the past in our traditional setting. I would contact your school, but I don't see why that would be a problem.
When do you believe, Mr. Duffy or Dr. Griffin, when we will know if the elementary students will have their own online full-time teacher?
Well, that's a question I'm going to talk about a little bit later. But specifically, we are still registering students, and I think we have a plan to look at that starting next week, and I believe hopefully the week of August the 3rd, we'll have those teachers identified at that point, and then we'll be communicating that. Any other questions, Dr. Jensen?
One more question. Can a student do both virtual and in the classroom if they have a doctor's appointment? And if in the middle of the day, for example, can they go to the virtual school and then attend class the rest of the day?
Good question, and we'll probably answer that here in a little bit too. But the short answer could be that potentially exists because students will have access to a class code to log in if they needed to. We wouldn't feel as though we don't want students to feel obligated that they have to do that, because we know doctor's appointments are going to happen, things are going to happen, but that opportunity technically does exist in the model that we're going to be presenting this evening.
One last question before you proceed. What about lunches for kids staying at home that qualify for free and reduced lunch?
Yeah, we want to work through Ms. Casey. She's our food service director, and we want to continue to be able to provide meals for our students who will be virtual learners, and we'll be sharing details of that very soon.
I believe it would be very similar to what we were doing in the spring, but Ms. Casey can answer those, and I think she'll be getting some information out soon. I want to talk a little bit about the digital synchronous learning experience, and the first thing that we want to talk about is you must have access to the internet during the school hours. So our elementary school hours are 8 to 2:30, with our middle school being 9 to 3:45, and you would need to have access to the internet during those hours. DSL, or the virtual options, I want to talk a little bit about those options that we have. And those options we are going to talk about, we'll talk about three different options. And option one will be that dedicated virtual teacher who will use Google Meet and Google Classroom with students daily. And that'll be our K through 6, and that'll be the model that we'll start off with. We also will have option B, which is the online learning experience where students will interact at the same time and in the same digital space. That's synchronous learning as students in the physical setting of the classroom. So grades 7 and 8 will really be focusing in that area, possibly some K through 6, depending upon the numbers. And again, we're looking closely at those numbers of students who are parents who are saying they want to be virtual, and we are still waiting on folks to register. So if you haven't registered yet, we ask that you register as soon as you can. That would help us out and help us plan and get the information to you as soon as possible. And then the students will attend, and what they'll do in their the DSL is they will attend the same schedule of classes via a remote location. So you would be at home, and instead of attending class in person, the live learning session will be utilized. It will be utilized in the classroom learning management system that we have, the LMS, and basically it would be like what we're doing tonight. So we are live tonight, and you guys are at your house. So very much like that would be option B. And option C really is an option that we wanted to offer to families because, and that's really a tool for families. And what we wanted to do is say to families, that's the asynchronous learning. That's the recorded lessons from the teacher, those recorded direct instruction from the teacher. And we really wanted to offer that to families who, that we would, it's for those students who maybe are at a daycare and they don't have the option of doing the digital at their daycare. So this would be an option for them. Or if both parents are working and they find it, and they're both working from home and they're finding it very difficult to help their student. And so really, when we're looking at this, this is a tool for those situations. We would encourage all students to be in the virtual learning on A and B, if at all possible, and use the option C as a tool to help if you and your family situation where you can't help your student, especially those younger students who kindergarten and first grade who may need help navigating that Google Classroom, especially at the beginning. And so that's what we have that option C for.
Mr. Duffy, yes. One quick question, since you're primary responsible for elementary. High ability, what will the high ability program look like at the elementary?
The high ability program, if you choose virtual with the high ability program, then it would be option B. It would be the option we just spoke about, and that would be the online learning experience where students are interacting at the same time. Basically, you'd be streaming into the classroom during those direct instruction times. So we would not have a dedicated teacher for that unless we just had a large amount of students that chose that. And the next slide we'll talk about is really, I had a lot of questions about from families about the school schedule and kind of what that would look like for elementary. What would that sample schedule look like? And this is a sample. Each teacher will make the adjustments to the schedule that works for them in their classroom. But this is just an example because of the questions that I received. Teachers will share their daily schedule with their parents once we've assigned that teacher, and then they'll share what their daily schedule will look like similar to this, and then also review that each day with their students and talk about the day when they meet with them. The students' responsibilities really are going to be to log in, and they would have to log in by 8 o'clock in elementary and by 9 o'clock in middle school, and they would need to mute their sound. They would need to keep their camera on. They would need to participate and ask questions, and we really highly encourage that piece. And then they would need to complete assignments in Google, in the Google Classroom format. Also, parents, we would need you to help students navigate that learning management system at first, especially those younger students. They may need help to stay on schedule. That might need help to navigate that and make sure that they are in the right place at the right time. So they might need a lot of support at the very beginning, but we believe it would be better as we go along with that. Students would need to as far as the direct instruction piece, students would need to be logged in during that direct instruction piece, and you can see that on your sample schedule there. And if you're asking what would that be, how long would that be, we're thinking anywhere between 2 and 3 hours of direct instruction. The rest of the day would be a lot of independent practice of that direct instruction that they learned from the teacher that day, that the teacher taught them that day. So I'll kind of review just a little bit of that. We start out each morning, and we'll do our morning meeting. We'll review the day. That's the opportunity that teachers will be building relationships and making connections with those kids. And that's a important part of our day. And they'll be doing that at 8 to probably 8:10 or 8:15. Then they'll jump right into the reading mini lesson. And this is the direct instruction piece we were talking about. Usually that lasts about 10 minutes, maybe 15 at the most. And at that point, after that, they would go to independent practice. So, again, depending upon what the teacher wants, they may have them step off out of that classroom, the virtual classroom at that time, and do that independent work on their own on Google Classroom, or they may do some guided practice. That's going to be dependent on the teacher. But many times it'll be independent practice with that lesson they just taught. Then we'll go to guided reading, which is our direct instruction with small groups. And so there'll be a small group in one and a small group in two. And then the rest of the students will be doing independent practice on literacy centers and different assignments that were made by the teacher on Google Classroom that are related to that reading mini lesson and to that guided reading lesson. Then we'll have a brain break in there of some kind, and then we'll do a word study mini lesson. Again, that direct instruction usually lasts about 10 minutes or so. The rest of the time will be independent practice, and again, we can ask them to step off of that computer and then go into the Google Classroom and do their assignments if they so choose to do that at that time. And then we'll have the writing mini lesson. Again, that's that direct instruction from the teacher that's very important. And then that independent writing time. And again, during that time, teachers may call students back into that virtual classroom to do some conferences with them, a conference on their writing, to look at their writing, talk to them about their writing, and then may even opt to share some writings at the end of that. We'll, of course, have lunch and recess and have breaks for that. And then we'll go to our math, and we'll do our daily math review, which is that direct instruction piece and guided piece together. And so they would be on with the teacher during that time. And then we would go in directly into our math lesson, which is another direct instruction piece. And then there would be some independent time on your math lesson as well. Probably the math lesson would last 20 minutes, maybe 30 at the most. And at that point, then they would go to independent practice. Next is Reflex, and that is our Math Facts practice. It's a computer program that we have, so they would be doing that on their own. Then they would go to specials, and specials really with art, music, PE, computer lab, and library, those would be either they would be working and they would have assignments in the Google Classroom in each of those classes. So one day they would do art, one day they would do music, one day they would do PE, and so on. And lastly, teachers would ask them to come back if they had any questions, if they needed any help. Again, chat is the place you can go in there and say, you know, I need some help with this, or they can come straight back in and ask them during that time. And there'll probably be other question times too. This is just an example that I wanted to put together for folks.
Couple questions, Mr. Duffy.
Sure.
First, class supply list for virtual students.
We don't have a specific class supply list for virtual students, although there are the teachers probably will reach out to you for that. I think if you're going to be working with your student at home, you are going to need some things that may be able to help. We are also talking about, and our principals have talked about, using some math manipulatives and some different reading type manipulatives that we are going to, and it will take us probably our first week of school or so, but we would like to get those to our parents so that we can offer those to you so that you will have those at home so that you can work with your child or your child can work with the teacher while with those manipulatives. So we're going to be giving those to parents, but it probably will take us about a week or so to get those in bags and set for you, and then we'll just call you and have you come in and have the virtual teacher tell you when you can come in and pick those up. But you may need some supplies at home, pencils, crayons, all those kind of things that you may need at home. So similar to what you would have in the classroom, but not exactly that. And I'm going to leave that to the virtual teacher to reach out to you guys and talk with you about that. But we will be providing some of that as we talked about.
Two clarifying questions. Will the traditional school start the same time as the virtual school? Students attend school the same time, same day?
Yes.
And then the next question, will DRA still be assessed and administered?
We are working with our literacy coaches at this point, and so we will be talking with our literacy coaches about how we can do that. I don't know if we can do that virtually or not. I need to speak with them when they get back, but we are going to assess them in one way, whether that can be virtually. If so, we'll do that. If not, we'll talk to you about an opportunity and time that you could come in and we could do that. But that is something we are still working on, about how we can exactly do that virtually.
One last question before you proceed. So if we decide to send our kids to school later in the fall, will they have a different teacher than they will doing digital?
The goal is no, because that's why we like the DSL model. So if I've formed a relationship with the teacher that I've been working with virtually, our goal is that they just slide right into the traditional model with that same teacher.
But again, I think some of that will depend upon numbers, and it will depend upon different other factors that we would not have control over.
Yeah,
at the time.
True.
But certainly I agree with Dr. Griffin. That is our goal would be to do that. Yes.
A couple things to remind our viewers at home here. First of all, you can follow this PowerPoint on our district website, nafcs.org. Follow right along there and view it later if you'd like as well. Also, we are recording this. So if you have any friends or family that would like to watch it later, they can definitely do that at their leisure on our YouTube channel. And then finally, this is an example of DSL right here, what we're doing. So we're trying to model what a close simulation of what our students that are going to learn virtually would see. Now, they're going to have their voices heard, and they're going to even be able to see, teachers will be able to see them as well. But this is a pretty close simulation of that as we interact together.
And Dr. Griffith, I forgot to make one point.
Okay.
And just another reminder, this is not like NTI from the spring. So just know this is totally different. The state has given us strict they've talked to us about we have to have instructions, a specific amount of instruction, we have to take grades, and we have to take attendance. So we will be doing all those things, and so this will be totally different than what it was in the spring.
Great point. So let's take a look at the middle school schedule. First of all, we'll take a look at a couple. This is fifth and sixth grade, total sample. I broke it into blocks of time. Most, I think, of our middle school parents are aware of the fact that we have teaming in fifth and sixth grade. So we have two teacher teams and three teacher teams. So depending upon which team your student would be a part of, this model here is more of a three-teacher model. So let's kind of just walk through what that would look like. Again, it's a sample. These times could change. The length of times are pretty accurate, but when these things occur could totally be at different times of the day. So as an example, the beginning of the day could be an elective for your child. So they would log in. Now with the electives, we're doing the DSL model where they're going to see their teacher, and they'll see students in there with the teacher. But the camera will be focused on the teacher, not really the class. So they'll be able to hear and interact with their elective teacher. Then they'll move to the second block there. That could be math, ELAR, the science, social studies, writing block. But I put math just as an example. And within that 90-minute block of time, I want to reassure you that students are not going to have screen time the entire 90 minutes. They'll do their daily math review with their teachers that they'll see virtually. Then they'll be given opportunity. I didn't put it there. I should have. Little mini lesson on whether we reviewed last night's math concept or we're going to introduce a new math concept. Then students are going to get an opportunity for some independent practice and review, and then also questions. Okay, so a teacher in that block of time may tell the virtual students, listen, we're going to do 20 minutes of independent practice, and at the end of 20 minutes, come back to the screen, and we're going to move on. So that's going to give students an opportunity to not be locked in. They'll be able to do some work at their workspace. Then students would move to lunch. They'd have an opportunity to take lunch. Then moving from lunch to the afternoon blocks of time, you see around noon to 1:30 or so, they would have English language arts. If this were their model, again, that could be math or social studies. Mini lesson, word work, guided and independent reading. This, again, is not 90 straight minutes of listening to a teacher lecture or give direct instruction. This is going to be some work in which, just like I said earlier, going to work independently, come back, lock in to what the teacher's directing them to do. And then the final block of time is the same that I've mentioned with the first two blocks. The core plus may or may not happen at the end of the day for the student. It's a sample, so that could happen in the morning, midday, but that's an opportunity for students to have a teacher to get extra help. If they don't need extra help, it could be an enrichment opportunity for them. It would definitely be an opportunity if you as a parent are home with them to do some work together on things that they either need extra help to do or really enjoy doing as far as schoolwork. So let's look at 7 and 8. And for those of you that tuned in last night, 7 and 8 is really similar to our high school model. So students are going to log in to their first period class. And Mr. Wonky is going to get into the how, because I'm sure a lot of people are thinking, this all sounds great, but how does this work? We're going to share that with you, because that's obviously critically important. But for now, we're looking at those. So they'll see seven live teachers, because they'll have seven classes to log into throughout the course of the day. Each class in middle school is between 45 and 50 minutes, and they'll have that lunch built in there as well. And school will end at 3:45. So what we'll want to do is simulate that as much as possible for a few reasons. One, we think it helps even virtual students form a relationship with teachers. And then when they are ready to come back, our goal is that they would be able to step in to the traditional setting for those students. They know who the teachers are. They know what the expectations are. So whenever you are ready as a family to bring your child back to school, we're ready to have you in a traditional setting. Shifting gears a little bit, let's talk about the student devices and what the responsibilities are. First of all, what sort of device will your child receive? Taking a look at grades 1 through 7, New Albany, Floyd, we're very proud of the fact that we are going to be able to offer one-to-one devices K through 12. So we're excited about that. We appreciate the help from the state and the federal government to help make that happen. But this year, we will be distributing Chromebooks to students in grades 1 through 7. They'll also come with a charger. Grades K and 8 will have an iPad with a charger. Now, remember, all these devices do belong to New Albany Floyd County Schools, and so we want to make sure that they're well taken care of. We also want to make sure that you know as a parent that we have filters on all of our devices that help protect your child, and it monitors the device. So we ask, we monitor all downloads, emails, student work, things like that. So we want to make sure students have the appropriate digital citizenship that we will be actually teaching in a lot of our classes early on how to appropriately use a device. But as a backup, we make sure that we are monitoring those devices pretty much 24/7. And what we'll have for you, and you've probably already seen it when you registered, and if you haven't registered yet, as Mr. Duffy said, we would strongly encourage you to do that. There's an existing acceptable use of a device policy, and that will need to be followed. We really are going to ask parents, you to work with us and help us educate your child on not trying to circumvent or disable this filter. That's just problematic. That becomes a problem for us, and it could, along with trying to repair a broken device, could void a warranty. So we ask that our students are taking good care of those devices. And if you have an issue, here's the number you can call. If you're having technology-related issues, please call this number, and we will be able to work you and your child through any issues that you may have. Students who have to get their devices repaired, we will be giving them a temporary device as a replacement there. Looking at device textbook and our device and textbook pickup, because in some cases we'll actually have some textbooks that we'll be distributing as well. So principals are going to be posting dates and times for device and textbook pickup for the very, very near future. So please check the school webpage for that, school social media. If you still can't find it, feel free to contact the school, but that information is going to be coming out very soon. And then as the PowerPoint shows here, this following information is going to also be provided when you pick up your device. We'll have a hard copy of the acceptable use of device agreement and then how to best care for the device. We'll also be giving you username and password credentials and then how to best operate your device. We'll be putting all those online as well. We do have a link that we just opened on our district site. It's a DSL virtual learning resources, and we'll be adding to that on a pretty much daily basis to try to give you all the tools you're going to need to help your child get going virtually this year.
Dr. Griffin, a couple questions.
Yes.
This first one's for Ms. Faree. What will it look like for a student who has a 504 plan for students who are virtually?
I think that we would certainly provide the accommodations outlined in the 504 plan, but again, that's going to be a situation where you're going to want to get together with that 504 team and look at what's the reasonable accommodations that are outlined in the plan and how will we provide those reasonable accommodations virtually. So I would encourage you to reach out to your 504 coordinator in your building. If you don't know who that is, please reach out to me and I can help you navigate that and both look at the plan and then help walk through what would the reasonable accommodations look like in that plan.
So a student, Ms. Faree, a follow-up question, a student who needs assistance in having a test read, how will that take place?
And we had a little bit of discussion about this last night with the high school group, but also have talked about this in-house in our shop. I think what we feel would be reasonable would be to have that student go to a separate Google meeting, Google Classroom, where we would have the reader available to read the test to the student over the Google Classroom platform.
A couple follow-up questions for either Dr. Griffin or Mr. Duffy. Class size for virtual classrooms, what will that look like?
Again, that's really we're gonna do all our very, very best to be able to socially distance in each of our classrooms, but it's gonna be dictated upon percentage of virtual and percentage of traditional students. So class size dependent upon grade level and actual school, it could vary.
And a follow-up question. In the spring, we did a lot of paper and pencil work. Right. What will the students who are virtually participating in our learning platform, what will that look like? Will that be different? Will students have to do paper and pencil, or can they post online?
They would be posting online through Google Classroom, so all their assignments would be on Google Classroom, and they'd be able to post on that. I think Mr. Wonky is going to talk about that real soon, I think, yeah. After one more slide, but that's a great question.
Okay, so let's talk connectivity real quick and how students will be able to get, and I'm going to steal a little bit of Mr. Wonky's thunder here, but all students are going to have an email address. And it's essentially the username at student.nafcs.org. So there's an example right there. If my name's John Smith, I may have the email address of jsmith@student.nafcs.org. We're encouraging the students, and we're expecting that students check that email every day, because right before the beginning of school, they'll be getting an email invitation from their teacher saying, hey, welcome to Dr. Griffin's first period biology class. Here is the class code to get into Google Classroom. Again, Mr. Wonky is going to talk you through some of those details. We are utilizing Google Classroom for our online platform and delivery. There is no parent portal so for Google Classroom, so you must use your students' credentials if you want to see their classes. But it is separate from PowerSchool. We have PowerSchool this year, but those of you that may remember iNow, so if you want to check grades and things like that, that's a separate situation there. Google Classroom will be where assignments will be posted and students will actually be able to turn in assignments, things like that. Students in grades kindergarten through fourth grade are just going to click on a link to enter Google Classroom. Pretty simple. Students in grades 5 through 8, and as well as high school, they're going to receive an email, like I said, from their classroom teachers that's going to invite them to class. There'll be a class code there. So I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Wonky to talk a little bit about class link.
Thank you, Dr. Griffin. So before we get into Google Classroom, we're going to take a moment to talk about ClassLink. And some of you may be very familiar with ClassLink as you've used it in the past to help your student access some of their content and materials that they're using in class. But ClassLink is something that we use for all students. There will absolutely be at least one need in order to go through ClassLink in order to access something for your students. And we use ClassLink as sort of a one-stop shop. It's one doorway and one key into a whole lot of different tools and resources. And so for students on iPads, they're going to find on their iPad an icon that looks exactly like this. This is our ClassLink icon. That icon is actually going to be down located in the bottom tray of their iPad. And so it's permanently locked there. We lock that in on our student iPads. They can't move it. They can't misplace it. They can't delete it. It's there for them. And all they will need to do is select on that icon, and they will be brought into ClassLink. And I'll demonstrate what ClassLink looks like in just a moment. For our students on our Chromebook, I'm going to step away from our presentation for a moment in order to demonstrate this. When I log into a Chromebook, ClassLink will actually be the first thing that populates. It's going to be the first screen that comes up. We have it set to where it automatically generates us into ClassLink. But if I step away from ClassLink, if I've jumped into a resource, a tool, and I'm gone and I need to come back to ClassLink, we have one very simple step in order to do this. And that is simply going to be opening a new tab within our Chrome browser and selecting the Home button. So in the very top left-hand corner up there, by back, forward, refresh, I have our Home button. I select my Home button, and I am loaded into ClassLink. And this is what ClassLink looks like. This is an example of a student. So this, your student may not see all of the different tools and applications that we have here, but they will certainly see some. And absolutely every student will see Google Classroom. And so I have Google Classroom tiled up there in the top left-hand corner. And so I'm going to navigate here in order to open Google Classroom as an elementary student. I'm going to provide two quick demonstrations here on Google Classroom, both of as an elementary student and as a upper middle school student or 7th and 8th grade student. We have our 5th and 6th grade students kind of fall in between here, and so you should be able to get a good idea of what it will look like for them as well. But when I'm an elementary school student and I log in to ClassLink and I click on Google Classroom, this is what I will see. I will see one class that my teacher has provided for me. And that teacher is going to name that class, and that teacher is going to set that up to suit their needs. But I will see my teacher's class. All I need to do to enter that class and to enter the Google Meet provided through that class, as well as all the class content that my teacher has created for me within it, is click on that class name. And now I am presented with all of my information for this class, starting with, and we are going to sidestep in a quick demonstration of Google Meet here and talk through Google Meet and some of its tools and particulars that we want you to know. We want all of our students to be aware of as we start school. And so all of our Google Classrooms have this Google Meet link, and I'm going to point it out even here. Right there at the top of our first screen, as it loads in. And so all a student will have to do when school starts, 8 a.m., 9 a.m., they come into their Google Classroom and they select that Google Meet link. What's happened here is I've actually done this on purpose. What we see here, if you read through all that, it's simply saying that right now, as a student, I cannot be in this meet. And I've done that on purpose to highlight that we certainly regard our digital spaces like we regard our physical classroom spaces. We want those students that are there in those digital spaces to be monitored and know that, hey, a teacher is there with them. And so we have prevented it to where a student cannot join this Google Meet unless the teacher is present. So I'm actually going to back out on my other device here. I'm going to start that meet as the teacher. So if you'll give me one moment to do so. I'm going to start that meet as a teacher, and now I'm going to start that meet as a student, and you'll see now I have the ability to step into that classroom, that digital space, as a student. And on this screen, this initial what I would consider a doorway screen, I actually have the opportunity to select how I want my microphone as well as my video. Again, we are asking all students to enter this Google Meet muted in terms of their microphone, but their camera on. And all of our Chromebook devices and iPads do have a camera on them. So we're going to mute the microphone here, and we are going to join this meeting. Now, this is going to look a little bit different here. My screen shifted because I'm actually presenting, or I'm seeing my teacher, which is over here on my teacher device. But this is what I will see as the student. I am going to see my teacher presenting in front of the classroom, whether it's I see them directly or I see something that they are presenting from their computer, such as a PowerPoint presentation or a Google Slide presentation. Before any further here, I want to take a quick moment to highlight an important accessibility feature within Google Classroom. This is extremely useful for our students, and it is closed captioning. Before I highlight this, I want to mention that this is an individual setting, meaning that the student themselves has to turn this on. This cannot be something that the teacher turns on for the student. So I'm going to unmute my microphone so that this will work, and I'm going to turn on closed captioning. And I'm going to move my cursor away so that that bottom bar drops away. But as I am now talking, you can see here my voice being picked up and it displaying all of the text that is being said. And so this is what will happen as well for those students. It will pick up the teacher. Right now it's picking up me as the student, but it will pick up the teacher and display everything that the teacher is saying and being said within this Google Meet. So if we have any students out there that need this as an item within their IEP or 504, we have some abilities in order to do so. As well, I want to highlight abilities to communicate and ask teachers questions within this Google Meet, and we have two ways that we can do so. First is simply by unmuting your microphone and asking the question directly to the teacher by just simply speaking out loud, and our teachers will hear that within their classrooms and be able to answer and respond to that question. As well, we have the chat feature within Google Meet, and so located up in the top right hand corner of that Meet, I have a chat bubble, and when I select that chat bubble, I am presented with this chat log that I can enter in a question of, could you repeat that please, for example. Okay, so I have two ways directly within this Google Meet in order to communicate with my teacher. Lastly, within Google Meet, I want to highlight that it is important for you to leave the Google Meet when it is time for you to leave. Your teacher, as a part of that daily schedule, is going to provide you different times to be in that meet and out of that meet. And we do ask that your students follow that schedule in terms of entering and leaving that meet when it is appropriate. The teacher is going to leave that meet or have that single meet be the meet for all day. So unless that student's pulled out for a particular reason, the time with that student and that one, their main teacher, is going to be the same meet link all day. So all I have to do as a student is leave that meet, and when I'm ready to rejoin, because it's my time to rejoin, I can simply click rejoin here on this screen, or back on my class screen, I can select that meet link again, and I'm brought back directly into that meet again. To take a quick trip here around Google Classroom, I want to highlight the stream. So we have three screens as a student. We have the stream here, top left, classwork in the middle, and people on the right. Within this stream, I am going to see announcements presented and posted by my teacher. These are going to be informational announcement items, meaning as simple as reminder, vocab quiz on Friday. I'm not going to see here class content or class work that I need to be completing as a part of being in that class. That's what the classwork section is for. And so we do have here some highlights of what this may look like. Again, this is going to be personal to the teacher and to the class. And this is what the teacher will be setting up. There are some topics that the teacher can use in order to place particular items together. For example, here in the elementary, we might have all of reading in one place. We might have all of writing or all of math in one place. But I will come here in order to find the work that I need to complete for the day and for this class. And speaking of work to do, I have here a couple of example assignments, one of them being the short story reading. And so in order to highlight what it looks like in order to receive work, complete work, and turn work in, we're going to take a look at this. So when I select and click on that short story reading, I see here some directions. Please read the provided short story and answer the questions on the provided sheet. So I have here two items. First is a PDF. That's my short story, so I can click on that. It's going to open up this short story, and I can read through that short story presented right here, one click away within Google Classroom. And then I see here, please answer the questions on the provided sheet. So I click on my provided sheet, and I am able to answer questions directly. I have here a set of questions that the teacher has provided, but I'm able to answer questions directly on this document. Make this a little bit easier to see. And I come in and I provide my answers. Excuse me that I'm writing gibberish, but for the sake of our example. And when I am done, all I need to do is click turn in the top right-hand corner. And so I've completed this work. I'm ready to turn it in to my teacher, and I click turn in the top right-hand corner. I'm going to be presented with, are you sure? Are you ready to turn this in? Yes, I am. And I select turn in again. And that's it. I've turned in and completed an assignment within Google Classroom. And that's what students will be expected to do on a regular basis for their class. Ready to talk middle school as well?
Yes, sir. I think
okay.
That'd be great.
So allow me one moment. If there's any questions, I'm going to have to switch here.
So let's take some questions. The first couple are for Mr. Duffy, kind of elementary related. First question, how does a student in a virtual setting work independently? How's that work when they are asked to do work independently?
Well, I think what I would envision is, as Mr. Wonky said, they would be, they could log off of the Google Classroom, actually the Google Meet part of that, where they're meeting with all those, and then they could go into Google Classroom and do any of the assignments that they have, that the teacher has posted for them, or any other assignment the teacher has asked them to do, whether that might be independent reading or whatever they ask them to do.
So a student who needs more time to improve their education, how do small groups work for students who are participating virtually?
We are going to have some small groups. I know in elementary, I'll let Dr. Griffin talk about that with middle school, but we will have some small groups for students who may need that. Our special education teachers, our EL teachers, our interventionist and literacy coaches will all be doing some small groups with those students, but also the teacher themselves will also be doing some small groups during some of that time, and it might be during that independent time where students are away from the Google Meet. They may be meeting them in that room to work with them specifically on what they were struggling with.
And then this final question, for some reason, all schools in our district have to shut down because of a COVID-19 closure. What would that look like, not only just for the virtual, but for the traditional student?
If we were K-12 had a closure, we would all become virtual students. So one of the first things we would probably do is ask most of our families to watch this video, and we may even create additional videos to support the families that haven't really delved into the virtual model. Now, even students that are traditional are going to learn a lot about Google Classroom, because I think we really want to transition to making that our LMS, where students are turning in assignments and things like that. So a K-12 shutdown, we would have further instructions for our traditional families on how we could transition as smoothly as possible to that environment.
Going to take a moment, step back again, and highlight a middle school, especially an upper middle school, 7th or 8th grade student, what their Google Classroom is going to look like. Instead of one class for one teacher, now I'm going to see 7 classes because I have 7 teachers. And so we see here 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th period. 9 o'clock rolls around for that middle school student. I select my first period class and I select my Google Meet link. I'm in with that teacher for about that 50 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
About that 50 minutes. I will do what is needed to be done within that class period. End of that 50 minute, I have that 5-minute passing period. I step out of my first period class. I step into my second period class. And again, I jump into my second period Google Meet. And so I will do that every day of school. And again, I have classwork here within these different classes. So each of my classes is broken down potentially in different ways as it's needed by my teacher and driven by my teacher. But this will be certainly the model for 7th and 8th grade students. For those 5th and 6th grade students there, we're looking at probably about 2 to 3 or 4 classes that they're going to see within Google Classroom. It's going to depend on what that team of teachers, number one, is it 2 teachers or 3 teachers, and what they have set up and designed for their class. I did want to take a moment before we step away from our examples here to talk about communicating through Google Classroom. There are 2 ways in which a student can do this. Number one is through the stream, as well as actually directly in classwork here through commenting. So as I see here within the stream, I have an announcement, a post that's within this stream. I can click on that item, and I see down here at the bottom, number one, class comments. So I can post a comment that's going to be seen by every other student in the class. As well, I have the ability to post a private comment directly to my teacher and only to my teacher about this particular announcement or post. Additionally, I have the ability under People, the People tab, and I see here my teacher. I am my own teacher in this example, but I can select that email icon off to the right, and it's going to open up our email window in order to for me to directly communicate with our teacher. Finally, one last point for me is to reiterate again that this is a different scenario from what we faced in spring. And a specific part of that for my presentation is the idea that all of our class content is within Google Classroom. We will all our teachers are posting all of their work, all of their content here. In order for you to access it, you're going to have to use your students' credentials in order to gain access to Google Classroom and see all of their work located there.
Mr. Wonky, quickly, I think we need to kind of show how the students will access and be invited to class K through 4, and then also the students grades 5 through 8.
You are correct,
sir. Kind of demonstrate that.
One moment. So in our K to 4 situation, the students will not have to do anything. They will actually have their classes auto-populated for them. In 5 to 8, they will face a similar situation like our 9 to 12 students will, in that they will receive an email from their teacher with a class code. So this class code is something that is individual to every class. So if I'm a 7th and 8th grade student, I'm going to receive 7 class codes, each of them specific to my specific classes. I will receive these in an email. And what I will need to do is I will need to navigate to Google Classroom. I will need to select my join class and this plus button icon in the top right hand corner. And when I select that, I get a small menu here, and I will enter that class code there. That class code is 7 characters. It's always 7 characters. It's lowercase letters and or numbers. And so I enter in my class code, 1 per class. I select join in the bottom right hand corner, and I'm now entered into that class and can receive all the content and the materials that that teacher is posting. Let me jump back to our presentation.
All right. Any other questions, Dr. Jensen?
Not at this time.
The student classroom expectations. I talked a little bit about that already, but it's really the students need to attend class on time, and that's big, by logging into the classes, Google Classroom. And just like in the classroom, they need to be on time, or that's a tardy. So we need to make sure that you are there on time and ready to go. The camera's turned on. We want to make sure that you're there and that the microphone is muted until you have a question or you're ready to speak. That you communicate with the teacher through Google Meet and email on a daily basis. Ask questions by unmuting your mic or in the chat box. But we really want this to be just like it is in the classroom, where you have an opportunity to ask questions and the teacher can respond to that. Complete all the assignments as well in Google Classroom. And that's another piece to this as well. Student expectations for specials and electives, that really is, we talked a little bit about that in elementary, and Dr. Griffin may talk a little bit about middle school with that. Do you want to talk about that at all on middle school specials?
Sure, I mean, we really will. We're going to do our very best with the elective courses, whether it be music, visual arts, PE, to give them the best virtual situation they can have. It won't be the same as face-to-face if you're not their PE, but the PE teacher may give virtual students some instructions that they can do some physical activity at their home. So it's going to be the next best thing, but as we mentioned at the beginning of this video, we feel like face-to-face is the best mode of instruction that we offer. But we know that the virtual won't be perfect, but we're going to make it as close to that as we can.
Absolutely. And in elementary, we're going to be doing our specials, as we talked about, one a day. And with those, there will be assignments posted on Google Classroom. And most of those will be in the video format for that lesson for that day for them. Students will receive instructions each day from their teacher directed through Google Meet and posted on Google Classroom. So that'll be there as well. And then students may work the majority of that period independently with those specials, and then check back in with the teacher at the end of the period or answer some questions that might be there for them to answer. The parent communication with the teacher. We encourage parents to contact their teacher, just like we do in the traditional setting, by email or a phone call. And really, that teacher should be reaching out. Once we set those virtual teachers, they should be reaching out and setting up their own open house or setting up their own opportunity to meet on Google Meet, probably, and to meet you, to talk about their classroom, talk about the expectations, to meet your students, and do the same with that as well. So they'll be reaching out as well. And then parents are encouraged to monitor their students' attendance and grades by using the PowerSchool parent portal. And we will have that available. Remember, PowerSchool is now our new system. And I now was the old one. You probably remember that a little bit. But so you'll be able to get on PowerSchool and do the parent portal. But remember, Google Classroom does not have a parent portal. And parents must get their student credentials for them to log in. I would encourage you to get your students' credentials and log in and check on that homework and check to make sure that they are following through and doing what they're supposed to be doing.
Mr. Duffy,
yes.
Just a couple of questions. Option C, a lot of the questions we're receiving tonight, can you kind of explain option C a little more?
Sure.
Kind of go through that.
Option C is really our asynchronous learning, and really that is recorded lessons, from that recorded lessons being recorded direct instruction from the teachers. And if you look at that schedule, you see where it says direct instruction. It's during those times that we would record those. And really that is a tool for families who, the only thing I can do is probably give some scenarios, but a family who is working from home now, and their significant other, their spouse, is working in the office somewhere else at their work site, and they're also watching someone like a grandmother who had just had surgery, and so they certainly had made that decision as a family that they wouldn't be sending their student to school, and they want to use the virtual. But they're working, and so they're working at home, and they really don't have the time to navigate those and help them follow through with that. So we would certainly like that student to try that. And we believe that students they learn very quickly. As you can tell, give them your phone or give them an iPad and they are figuring things out. You're thinking, I don't even know how they did that, but they'll figure it out, but they're going to need help at the very beginning. But so we ask that you try that and try to make that work. If it doesn't work, we do have the other option, which is we have that recorded. So we have those direct instruction recorded. We don't believe that's as good as being live with the teacher, either in the classroom or virtually, because there's that interaction, there's questions back and forth. That really can't happen with that recorded piece. But we understand there's family situations, so we wanted to offer that for those that would need that to make that work for them and their family. Dr. Griffin, anything?
Yeah, no, I agree with everything Mr. Duffy shared there. Really, again, priority face-to-face, best instruction we can provide. Second best is our virtual, live virtual, the digital synchronous learning. That's the next best thing because students can interact on a live basis, ask questions. The third is the recorded. Now, the recorded, again, it takes away that interactivity, takes away being able to ask questions and things like that. So we would encourage all parents to choose option A or B. And even if a student is struggling with option B, as working families, you could go back to option C to reinforce that evening.
And also, in all of those options, assignments will be made, and then assignments would be expected to be completed, and attendance as well. So all those would be the expectations. Dr. Jensen?
Yes, just a couple of questions here. Dr. Griffin, maybe you could kind of explain how PE would look like at the middle school level when a student is participating virtually.
couple different examples I could provide. One would be that the PE teacher would be introducing what they're going to be doing in the gym or outside, and then giving as close to possible that activity for students to do at home. Now, if they don't have the needed equipment, it's going to be an alternative activity. Run around the house 10 times, or this many push-ups, this many sit-ups. I mean, there's some different things. It will not be the same because they're not in the physical setting of physical education. And there'll be those situations in which the student will be expected to do those things, and the honor system will come into play a little bit, because when you're given a virtual activity to do, the PE teacher also will have traditional students in front of them. So it's not going to be perfect scenario, but it's going to be as best as we can make it.
And now we're on the virtual learning resources in our New Albany Floyd County webpage, and you can see that. Do you want to talk about that?
Yep, that's on our main site. If you go to nafcs.org, you will see the DSL virtual learning resources, and we're adding things to that every day. Chromebook, how to use a Chromebook, parent guide to Google Classroom, student guide to Google Classroom. We'll continue to add that as a resource to you. So we're hoping that's going to be useful for you. And we also, you know, reach out to our teachers and our schools. We're all learning together. This is still new to a great deal of us as educators. We're nervous but very excited about what we're going to be able to offer our students this year, definitely.
And did you guys get to see what Mr. Wonky was putting up on the monitor there? Because I think that showed where he was going for that information.
Yep. So the DSL virtual learning resources there.
Sure.
Do we have any other questions?
Yes, Dr. Griffin, one question, or maybe this is more for Mr. Duffy.
Sure.
To explain how the special in the library works.
Well, the library special really, probably what we would do in the library special and what we're going to do is there will be an assignment in Google Classroom, and what we would do is have you go to Myon, and that's a program that we have that has books, and students pick out books, and that would be their independent reading time. Also, we are going to be, so it's like their library would be this Myon site they would go to. And the other one is our literacy coaches are going to be assigning read-alouds. So just like in our library where we have our library specialist who would be helping students pick out books, they would do that on Myon on their own. And then also just like they would do a read-aloud in the library as well. So they would be there would be a video of a read-aloud on their Google Classroom where they would just click on, and that would be their library.
One last question here. Probably for Dr. Griffin, how will band and orchestra be conducted in the virtual setting?
Similar to PE, we're going to have the DSL option. The teacher will be live. It's probably going to be a little more difficult for, let's say, a fifth grader that's a beginning band member that has zero experience in band. But we're going to try to do our best to simulate that traditional classroom as best we can. Just like I said, with physical education, it's not going to be perfect. But we're going to be able to, provide the best instruction we possibly can for band, orchestra, choir students.
That's all the questions
all
I
right.
have at this
Great.
Point.
Great. Listen, yeah. I'd like to give special thanks to Mr. Bill Hamby and Mr. Phil Wesley for making this live stream possible. Thank you very much. Also, everybody on our panel here today.
Complete registration.
Oh, yeah. I'm reminded. Please complete registration. That helps us tremendously.
Absolutely.
As we move forward, please complete registration. I know Mr. Briscoe sent out a phone call yesterday, and we're going to remind you, too. We'd love that to happen before the end of the week, as soon as possible, if you could. And then finally, just a reminder here, everybody in this room is not only an educator, but we're also a parent.
Absolutely.
We understand how you feel. We understand, and we take that very, very seriously, not only before this pandemic. I mean, we've always felt that way, but especially we now, and we want to work with you and partner with you through this very unique, challenging, but yet exciting year. That's it.